If there's any Spanish media here, I can do Spanish after the initial presentation. But what I want to do is I want to start off, first of all, my name is Eddie Hernandez. I'm a lieutenant, Sheriff's Homicide Bureau. I'm overseeing this case. I want to start all the way to my left. We have Stephen Katz, Sheriff's Homicide Bureau Captain, Lead Investigator Eddie Brown, Lead Investigator Tony Martinez. I have the station, Compton Station Captain Michael Thatcher here. So the reason we're here is to announce that thanks to the Compton City Council, special thanks to the Mayor and City Councilwoman Emma Sharif, they've authorized a $10,000 reward for information leading to the identification, arrest, and conviction of the individuals responsible for the murder of Roberto Lucio. Mr. Lucio was shot and killed June 28, 2015, as he stood on the sidewalk with his girlfriend and his infant child. The suspect, who's depicted in that board there, drove past Mr. Lucio, exited his vehicle, walked towards the trunk of the car, and aggressed Mr. Lucio, who was standing there and apparently was caught off by surprise, as there was no attempt to flee or anything like that. The suspect shot at him multiple times, striking him. When he shot at him, his infant child and his girlfriend were right next to him, and the suspect fled. Investigators have been working on this case since it started. All of the initial leads have been exhausted, and so it is our hope that by bringing this to the public, also letting them know that there's a reward available for their cooperation, we're hopeful that that will create additional leads that will lead to the arrest of the individual. The suspect is described as an African-American, about 6 feet, 250 pounds, short hair, and he was wearing dark clothing at the time. His vehicle is a newer Kia Optima, dark gray in color. It had tinted windows and it had paper plates that read Car Pro. So this shooting occurred in daylight hours in a residential area. But we're hopeful that somebody who saw anything, whatever it is, would help us continue having this investigation go forward. Obviously, you can call the Sheriff's Homicide Desk. That's a 24-hour desk. That's 323-890-5500. Also, we encourage everybody to go through Crime Stoppers, as you can remain anonymous if you like. And there's different mediums that you can use to provide tips. So at this point, I'll open up to some questions. Yeah, that's unclear because there's no evidence that the Mr. Lucio and the suspect knew each other. However, if you look at the suspect's actions, that he stopped, went past him, exited his vehicle, and then directly and specifically aggressed him, that's what makes it unclear for us. But there's no indication that they knew each other, at least not at this point.
Can you describe the area, Lieutenant? I mean, we're talking a residential area that's happening, or?
Yeah, residential area, mainly residential area, highly densely populated, and the Lucio family has lived there for a long time.
Did you have any witnesses? Who gave you the composite?
That information came from family members.
Family members. So, what information was the? Did you say with girlfriend or wife?
Girlfriend or the mother of his child. Yeah.
What information was she able to give?
Well, she just exactly what I just put out.
She was your primary witness, obviously.
She's one of the people that saw.
In the area.
Correct. Yeah.
The Kia, do you usually have those rims just to kind of consider those normal or?
They look aftermarket, but obviously we don't know if they were.
Did he have it came with aftermarket rims?
I don't know, but they do. I'm not familiar with the Kia accessories that come with those cars, but it looked pretty clean, and it obviously it's similar to that, and so that could stand out as well.
And then the paper plates came from car throw, is that something you guys can look into? Can you go to a business and ask them who they might have sent this car to in the last 6 days?
Well, unless there's any, you know, we would need some identifying marks, you know, van or, I mean, if all their car, if they have a bunch of multiple Optimas that they sell there, I mean, it's obviously something we can look into, but we would probably need a little bit more to try to track something down from them. Because I don't know if that dealership is a chain store or is just a mom and pop's dealership.
Any indication this guy, you know, it feels like we've been doing so many of these lately, but do you feel this guy got any gang ties or any past that is back to haunt him?
Well, all I will say is that the victim has a criminal past, but it was when he was younger, and I'm not going to really get into the specifics of it, but it was when he was younger. He just recently had a child. He was working at Home Depot, and there's no indication that he was active in a gang at the time of his murder.
Any identifying tats or clothing that would give that impression?
Not that we have, yeah. Sure. Well, I think a couple things. Broad daylight, which is pretty bold, in a residential area, and also the fact that he was standing near his girlfriend and the infant child, where a stray bullet could have easily hit all three of them. And so those things obviously are concerning, because it increases the public safety concern for us that somebody would deliberately do that when there's people around. And, you know, the stray round could have hit a residence or something like that, yes. So, yeah. Okay, so we're joined up here with Roberto Lucio's sister, Gladys Lucio, and Antonio Lucio, who is the father. And I'm going to ask his sister maybe to say a couple words about Roberto. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My brother was a hardworking man who had dreams and goals to accomplish throughout his life. And as a 25-year-old, you're still in the progress of working on those future goals. And he was building his future to provide for his 2-year-old daughter and give all the necessities he never had. He worked for Home Depot, and his life was just taken away instantly. And it's been hard for us, because nobody should die the way he did. Thank you.
That takes a lot of courage to come up here and talk about your family member and relive the experience. So thank you, Gladys. Any other questions? If there's no other questions, we'll end the press conference, and then I can do some Spanish. Go ahead, sir.
May I ask Gladys?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Gladys, we can hear your mom crying in the background. Like, this happens more often than not. People who do it don't realize the effect that it has on family.
Mm-hmm.
So can you help us understand how this has affected your family?
Well, it's kind of hard to explain, because it's like you never, living in Compton, I always saw people, you know, get killed, but as soon as it struck to me when it happened to me, it changed my whole perspective about everything and the community, and you just have to, like, live and kind of use that as like a key to keep on going. And I guess family support has been helping us, the friends, all the friends and family that came over to help us, that was really important for us. And it's been very tough, but with the family support and friend support, it's what's keeping us. I'm still pretty angry, because nobody has a right to take anybody's life away. but yeah.
What do you think happened?
I'm not sure, but I wish I knew what happened and why he did it, but I have no comments on why or what happened.
Can you tell us a little bit about how his child's doing and the mother of the child? How are they doing?
They're doing good. The daughter, she's getting bigger, but,
Do you get to see him, and does the family get to visit?
I don't want to comment on that.
Okay.
Yeah. What I want from the public is to help us find him. If there's any little detail that anybody knows about, I would really appreciate it if they can contact the detectives, because any little detail matters right now, and what's important is to find him, because I think we should stop him before he does it to anybody else, because I don't want that to happen to anybody else.
Español. Bueno, es que mataron a mi hijo el 28 de junio. A Robert, él trabajaba para Home Depot. Lo mataron en la mañana, a las 11 de la mañana. Yo estaba delicado de salud, estaba dormido cuando oí los balazos. Yo salí, él entró primero. Entró por un dinero para comprar un papel, un troco blanco que llevó. Y vi que salió corriendo a pagar el dinero, pa, y le llegó a pagar el dinero y ahí le dispararon, ya lo estaban esperando a mi hijo. Entonces yo vi los balazos, salí. Cuando yo salí, yo no vi al tipo. Yo ya estaba dentro del carro. Ya nada más vi que se movió así algo en el carro, como que andaba otra persona al lado del pasajero. Y el chofer se acostó sobre el volante, así, que me agarró a tiro de frente. Entonces yo estaba en el cancel, me quedé así. Entonces yo tenía la pluma para agarrar las placas, pero no tenía placas. Nomás decía Pro Toyota, decía el carro, pero el carro era Kia. Entonces yo no pude agarrar nada, salió, se fue. Ya corrí yo a ver a mi hijo, y a mi hijo ya había caído en el zacate, cayó en la banqueta, amigo. Ahí cayó muerto, pegó el puro corazón. Y fui, corrí, lo abracé, pero ya estaba muerto. Yo lo levanté todavía y lo abracé, pero ya estaba muerto. El tipo se fue. Yo no le vi la cara. Dijeron que era moreno. La esposa sí lo vio. Y el del troque blanco también lo vio. Yo no lo vi. Dejó a abrir el carro cuando salió. Y fue todo ya. Pero nadie me ayudó, porque mucha gente vio. Había carros ahí y no lo siguieron. Y pues yo dije, bueno, ni modo. Ahí quedó mi hijo tirado muerto. Afuera.
¿Cómo ha afectado
a la familia? ¿Mandé? Pues mucho, nos ha afectado bastante, porque pues mi señora no puede quedar sola en la casa por los nervios, pues, porque piensa que está la él en el cuarto y él, la donde estaba él, la recámara está cerrada. No he sacado todavía nada, porque él había venido a visitarme. Me dijo, papá, ¿sabes qué? ¿Me puedes dar permiso? Dijo, voy a agarrar un apartamento, un cingo, porque él estaba en otro lado. Le dije, sí, hijo, vete. Le dije, la señora no estaba con él, la señora vivía en Hampton Park. Y la niña, dijo, voy a juntar con ella. La muchacha dijo, vamos a cambiar, y vente aquí. Le dije, ya dije, la cámara, mientras que agarras tu cingo. Y ya, pero me pasó así. El banco tiene, la cuenta del banco no me la han querido entregar, nada de eso, del dinero, no quieren. No me han entregado, son 1,400 lo que tiene el banco. Yo quería dárselo a la niña y no quisieron dármelo, el Banco de América. Y pues ni modo. Y la niña, ahí está la niña, que va a cumplir 3 años para noviembre. La niña. Yo a la señora no le he visto, porque no le lleva la niña, para nada. No la lleva. Pero nomás me dijo, si puede ir a firmar para el Seguro Social. Y sí, ya sabes, pues la niña. Dije, y hablando, le dije, vamos para ayudar a la niña, pero no la lleva. Y fui y le firmé al Seguro Social para que le dieran la ayuda para la niña. Porque él, como trabajaba para Home Depot, y pues hasta eso Home Depot se portó bien, todos fueron allá a la casa, nos ayudaron. fue bastante la ayuda, pues, por lo que era muy trabajador mi hijo, porque mi hijo se dedicaba a trabajar. Toda mi familia es muy trabajadora, toda, todos mis hijos. Yo tengo ahí una casa esa desde el 85. No he salido porque esa casa es Hapsen, es casa de gobierno, entonces por eso no he salido. Yo tengo desde el 85 ahí, no he tenido problemas. Y mi hijo, yo para mí, a mi hijo llegaron a matarlo directo, fue directo. Eso a mí que no me digan que son de pandillas o no es de pandillas, eso fue directo a él. Porque ese carro ya me habían dicho que había dado la vuelta. Una vez ya dado la vuelta y lo vieron. Ya dado la vuelta y en la segunda vuelta fue cuando lo mató. Eso no es de pandilla, eso fueron a matarlo directamente a él. Sí.
Gracias.
Es todo.
Gracias.
Okay, so we're going to go ahead and end this. And then if you guys want to talk to the family or you want to talk to me on the side, we'll go ahead and continue with the stand-up. Thank you.